the vaccine, and the faithful. A closer look at whether there are moral issues in a possible breakthrough to fighting COVID-19. Ballot battleground, what the Trump administration is saying about the vote counts in several swing states. Legal action. New developments in the case against Cardinal Angelo Becciu weeks after being ousted from his job at the Vatican. And model of prayer. Pope Francis reminds the faithful to follow the example of the Blessed Virgin Mary. We'll explain. On EWTN News Nightly for Wednesday, November 18th, 2020. Good evening. Thanks for joining us tonight. I'm Tracy Sable. Tonight, hope in the race for a vaccine. Pfizer is set to file an emergency authorization this week for its coronavirus vaccine with the FDA. The drug company says new test results show the vaccine is 95% effective and also protects older people who are at most risk of dying. Correspondent Mark Irons reports. Mark?
Tracy, this announcement comes just a week after Pfizer revealed preliminary results that were positive, and they will ask U.S. regulators for emergency use this Friday. Meanwhile, Catholics may be asking if this vaccine and others are ethical options. Pro-life organizations have been following these developments closely.
Coronavirus case numbers are on the rise around the world as vaccine makers share hopeful news. Pfizer and its German partner BioNTech say they have completed phase three and gathered final data of their COVID-19 vaccine. Latest test results show it jumped from 90 to 95% effectiveness. BioNTech CEO on the promising results.
The risk for getting COVID-19 if you are vaccinated is 20-fold less as compared to having no vaccine.
The National Catholic Bioethics Center has described the Pfizer vaccine as an ethical option. On EWTN Pro-Life Weekly, the president of the NCBC said no aborted fetal cell lines were used in the vaccine development.
It's a new type of vaccine, the mRNA type, similar to the Moderna vaccine that does not use any cell lines whatsoever in its production. So in that case, there are no cell lines involved in its development or production.
The vaccine developed by Moderna is also showing high rates of success, reducing the risk of COVID-19 infection by almost 95%. The pro-life Charlotte Lozier Institute calls it one of the ethically uncontroversial COVID-19 vaccine programs.
The Moderna vaccine and the Pfizer vaccine that are using what's called RNA. It's an RNA strategy in which there are no cells that are used at all in the production process.
The stamp of approval comes as a Catholic bishop has called the Moderna vaccine into question. Texas Bishop Joseph Strickland says the vaccine is, quote, not morally produced. But Tracy, both of those pro-life bioethics organizations we spoke to said that is not the case. Tracy.
Okay, thank you so much, Mark. Correspondent Mark Irons reporting for us tonight. And coming up later in the show, an update on the fight against the coronavirus from Dr. Jerome Adams, Surgeon General of the United States. Democratic Senator Chuck Schumer is calling for bipartisan COVID-19 relief talks, but Senate Republicans say Democrats are the ones standing in the way.
A majority of United States senators, 52 senators, voted for coronavirus relief, not once, but twice, once in September, once in October. Not a single Democrat voted for it.
Republicans go on to say Democrats are accusing the GOP of using tactics they themselves are using to stand their ground on COVID-19 relief negotiations without budging. Tonight, President Donald Trump is continuing to protest the election results on Twitter, now claiming, quote, the Georgia recount is a joke and is being done under protest. He is not happy about Michigan either. This as presumptive President-elect Joe Biden meets virtually with frontline healthcare workers battling the pandemic. White House correspondent Owen Jensen reports. Owen.
Tracy, the Trump campaign will spend millions of dollars for a partial recount in Wisconsin. In Georgia, the president says thousands of fraudulent votes were found there. In Michigan, he says Democrats cheated and got caught. Twitter pushed back on those claims, and Michigan's governor isn't buying it either.
The vote was overwhelming. Joe Biden won Michigan by 14 times the number of votes that Donald Trump won Michigan in 2016. We had a full, free, fair, and secure election. The will of the people will stand.
Election controversies aside, Catholics are still digesting Joe Biden's apparent victory. He's Catholic, yes, but does not adhere to the church's most important doctrine, protecting unborn children.
When politicians who profess the Catholic faith support them, there are additional problems. Among other things, it creates confusion with the faithful about what the church actually teaches on these questions.
Meanwhile, the transition of power and the pandemic colliding. Now, presumptive President-elect Joe Biden met with frontline healthcare workers today. President Trump's Operation Warp Speed quickly developed vaccines. It's up to the next administration to get those vaccines out to Americans. And let's go back to Michigan for a second. Wayne County, there was a big uproar when at first they weren't going to certify the election there. Then there were charges of racism. In the end, the election results were certified, much to the chagrin of President Donald Trump. Meanwhile, Republicans are still trying to stop formal certification in states like Arizona, Nevada, and Pennsylvania. Tracy?
White House correspondent Owen Jensen reporting for us tonight. Thank you so much, Owen. Former Vatican official Cardinal Angelo Becciu has filed a civil lawsuit against an Italian newspaper. Cardinal Becciu, who resigned from his rights of cardinal, is accusing L'Espresso weekly paper of what he called enormous damages. In September, reports said the 72-year-old was being investigated for financial misconduct. Cardinal Becciu denies the claims. Among his resignation, he was ousted from his job as the head of the Holy See's Congregation for the Causes of Saints. Coming up, the Surgeon General of the United States gives us an update on the fight against COVID-19. And a U.S. bishop tells us why he still has questions about the Vatican's report on former Cardinal Theodore McCarrick. One of the items discussed in the virtual Fall General Assembly of the U.S. Conference of Catholic Bishops this week was the Vatican's report into former U.S. Cardinal Theodore McCarrick. McCarrick was laicized last year following decades of sexual abuse of minors and seminarians. In the wake of the Holy See's report, the USCCB called for prayer, fasting, and reform. But one church leader is seeking something else. He wants information on McCarrick's possible financial misconduct. Joining us now is Bishop Michael Olson, the head of the Diocese of Fort Worth in Texas. Your Excellency, welcome back. Thank you so much for coming on the show today. So tell us, why do you feel it's important to have more information on McCarrick's financial transactions, and what specifically are you hoping to learn?
Well, I'm not the only one with these questions. These are questions that the faithful are putting to me and to other bishops to try to address here in the local church. These questions that arise is that whenever we have incidents of sexual misconduct, frequently financial misconduct is not far behind. In the case of McCarrick, the report does say that he spent a lot of money, gave a lot of gifts, but it doesn't say who received that money, what organization, what cleric received that money, and knowing that will help us to change the system into greater accountability and responsibility. It would articulate what was done with the money, why was it given, why was it offered. This is not just an issue within the church itself, but of course McCarrick traveled in other circles worldwide, in businesses and high finance, as well as international relations. And so it's important that for the sake of our integrity as a church, as the Holy Father wants us to eradicate sexual abuse, that we take care of this, that will help to destroy the environment where this can endure.
What impact or benefit do you think this will have for the faithful when it comes to restoring trust and healing?
What are you referring to specifically? The report?
As far as coming out with more information on financial transactions.
Well, I think it will help to restore the faithful, because there's a sense of a firm purpose of amendment that follows an expression of contrition. It's not unlike what was produced in the report on Bishop Bransfield, where amounts of money were released, who received it. Bishops were able to give an explanation as to why that was, and they've been able to move forward and begin moving forward in the Diocese of Wheeling-Charleston. I think the same could apply here in this case.
Your Excellency, are there other members of the USCCB who share your concerns and would like a deeper dive into former Cardinal Theodore McCarrick's financial dealings?
Well, discussions within the conference are just beginning. You know, we just received the report just about a week ago, and so the conversations are just starting as far as what is our accountability and what is our responsibility as members of the hierarchy in the church in the United States. I think Archbishop Gomez gave that answer in the press conference at the end of the day on Monday, you know, that it's just, we're still just digesting it and we're discussing it and you know, in a spirit of gratitude to the Holy Father for permitting this investigation to go forward.
I want to switch gears just a little bit. What were your main takeaways from the USCCB Fall General Assembly?
The overall assembly? There were challenges with its virtual presentation in the sense we didn't get really a chance to visit with each other outside of the meetings. In some ways, it was more efficient just because we were better prepared, I think, in the meetings going forward. I think we adjusted well to the technology of it. I think Archbishop Gomez's closing remarks regarding the pastoral situation involving Mr. Biden, both as a Catholic and as president-elect, as far as how do we address him as a Catholic first in our responsibility as shepherds, and then also in his role as president. And I think the proactive approach of the conference is a good start on that.
Well, Your Excellency, thank you so much for coming on. We really do appreciate your time. Bishop Michael Olson, the head of the Diocese of Fort Worth in Texas. Thank you again.
Thank you.
Well, a newly released report finds Americans are steadfast in their belief in the importance of religious freedom and drawing on their religious identities to face the challenges of this year. The second annual Religious Freedom Index, published by the Becket Fund for Religious Liberty, finds 62% of respondents said faith or religion was important to them during the coronavirus outbreak. And more than three-quarters of the respondents said religion is important to providing stability to society during times of social unrest. Joining me now on Skype with more on the report is Caleb Lyman, Director of Research and Analytics at Becket. Caleb, welcome. Thanks so much for coming on. What were the factors or elements that you looked at in order to gauge how Americans view religious freedom?
Yeah, happy to be here. The index measures 21 different indicators of religious freedom. So those are 21 questions about different aspects of religious freedom in order to cover a wide range, the full spectrum of religious freedom protections in America. So we take those 21 questions, and each year those are categorized into six dimensions of religious freedom that contribute to this overall index score that allows us to track religious freedom opinion and sentiment among Americans over time.
What were the three key findings of this year's report?
This year we found that Americans are using religion, they're relying on religion to get them through the storms of this year, that they're drawing on their religious identity to do so, and that there are some leadership gaps in defending both racial justice and religious freedom. So we found that Americans, as you mentioned, are relying on their faith to get them through the pandemic. 62% of respondents said that their faith was important to dealing with the challenges that they were facing in the pandemic. And also that religion is not just part of something that Americans do, it's something that is part of who they are. More than 60% of respondents said that for some people, religious identity is who they are and should be protected accordingly. And lastly, that when people are voting, when they're making decisions about who to vote for, the candidate's stance on religious freedom is important, but that at the same time, they don't see that their elected officials are necessarily doing the best job of religious freedom, that they actually think the courts are doing the best job of religious freedom.
I know this is the second year you've taken a look at this. Was there anything else that stood out to you or differences or trends that you're watching now that you can compare data to?
Yeah, I think one of the most interesting changes for us to see was in a question where we asked respondents about whether they see people of faith as part of the solution or part of the problems that are facing our society. And there was a slight increase among those that said that people of faith are part of the solution. This year, 62% of respondents said that people of faith are part of the solution to those problems. But I think even more interesting is that there was a 7% increase among those that said people of faith are definitely part of the solution. So in a year when we are facing so many problems and when people are looking to government and to science to help solve those problems, I think it's really encouraging that people also think that religion and people of faith can be a source for those solutions.
Absolutely. I know this year, as a nation's been dealing with the coronavirus pandemic, we've also seen renewed calls for racial equality and justice. I want to look at another finding from the index. You mentioned this briefly before. 84% of those surveyed who said faith was important also think that religious organizations and people should have a role in advocating for racial equality and justice. What do you see as the takeaway there for religious leaders and organizations?
Right. So we see that there's a really clear call that people of faith think that religious organizations should be involved in advocating for issues of racial justice. And then we also asked another question of that same group of people that asked whether they think their religious community, their faith community, is doing a good job of advocating for religious freedom or for racial justice. And only half of those surveyed said that their community had done a good job. There was a lot of ambivalence expressed on this issue. So we see a really clear desire to have engagement on the issue of racial justice, but much more ambivalence and not as strong an evaluation of their faith community's job in dealing with those issues. So we think there's a chance for faith communities across the country to step up here and to advocate for racial justice in the way that their communities think that they should.
Well, Caleb, thank you so much for your time. We really appreciate it. Caleb Lyman, Director of Research and Analytics at Becket. Thanks again.
Thank you for having me.
Up next, Pope Francis points to the Virgin Mary as an example for our modern lives. Promising news in the development of a COVID-19 vaccine comes as the number of coronavirus cases in the nation continues to rise. According to Johns Hopkins University, there are more than 161,000 new cases in the U.S. Joining me now to talk about where we are in the battle against COVID-19 is Dr. Jerome Adams, Surgeon General of the United States. Dr. Adams, welcome back. Great to have you on, and thank you for your time. As we see the number of coronavirus cases rise across the country, what do you see as key or most needed to reverse that trend?
Well, I'm terribly concerned about the trends. You mentioned them. In the last 30 days, we've gone from 50,000 cases per day to over 150,000 cases per day, almost a 300% increase. And that's translating into hospitalizations going up from about 5,000 cases per day, hospital admissions 30 days ago, to over 10,000 cases per day now. And I'm really worried about my fellow healthcare workers getting overwhelmed. I'm worried about people having heart attacks and strokes and being in car accidents and not being able to get the care that they need because the beds are full of COVID patients. So what I want everyone to understand is that what you've done so far has saved lives. It truly has. But the dynamics of spread are changing. More and more spread is occurring not in the public square, but in the household setting. And so we need to be especially cautious about our social bubbles, making sure we're not expanding them too quickly, especially as we go into the holiday season, being cognizant of the fact that each new person you're around adds to your risk.
I know that you've talked about what's being referred to as pandemic or COVID fatigue. Let's talk a little bit more about that and the possible dangers, and how do we as a nation overcome that?
Well, it's important for everyone to understand that we all have a role to play. From a federal perspective, we're trying to provide resources, manpower, guidance, But on a local level, everyone has to do their part. And I know people are getting tired. It's tiring when you're running a race and you don't think you're ever going to get to the finish. So it's why it's so important that people understand that this week, we actually had two different vaccines have results shared showing that they were 95% effective. We will start vaccinating people within weeks. We don't need to do these things forever, but we need to be really cognizant about them right now. And when I say these things, I mean wearing a mask, washing your hands, watching your distance, and remembering that this Thanksgiving, the safest way to spend it is with the immediate members of your household only. But if you're going to be around other people, please go to cdc.gov and review the tips that they have for a safer holiday gathering. You can find them simply by Googling CDC holiday gathering. We've all got to do our part for a little bit longer. Otherwise, it's going to be a really bad next 4 to 6 weeks.
Any other advice for folks how to celebrate the holidays safely? Because people do want to gather and be with their families this time of year.
Well, if you're going to gather together, know whether or not you or someone who you're gathering with is at higher risk. Chronic medical conditions, diabetes, heart disease, lung disease, because those are people who really should stay at home. Make the gathering as small as you can, ideally less than 10. Outdoors is better than indoors. And one of the things I'm encouraging people to do is to be particularly cognizant about their social bubbles leading into Thanksgiving. Consider asking everyone who's coming to try to quarantine themselves before the holiday gathering, knowing that it takes an average of 5 days for symptoms to show up. The longer you can be not around other people, the safer it will be for you to gather together this holiday season. But again, 3 W's, wear a mask, wash your hands, watch your distance, and get your flu shot this year. It's not too late, and that's another way you can help protect hospital capacity and prevent from disrupting the holiday gathering. You don't want to be the one with a fever or a cough or a sore throat because of the flu, but scaring everybody and forcing them into quarantine because they're scared that you have COVID.
All right. Well, thank you so much. All great advice. We appreciate your time. Dr. Jerome Adams, Surgeon General of the United States. Thank you again for your guidance.
Thank you. CDC holiday gatherings.
Carnival Cruise Lines announced today that it's putting all of its U.S. operations on pause until the end of January, and many Carnival cruises will be postponed even longer. It's all because of the coronavirus pandemic. Carnival and other cruise lines are following CDC guidelines on when it is safe to set sail once again. In South Korea, health officials are reporting the highest daily number of new infections since August. 313 new COVID-19 cases were registered yesterday. Most were transmitted locally. Starting today, the government is strengthening social distancing requirements in the capital of Seoul. Thousands of Germans protest against Chancellor Angela Merkel's coronavirus restrictions. Protesters banged drums and blew whistles in the center of Berlin this morning. The German parliament was passing laws on restricting social contact, wearing a mask, and drinking in public. Riot police ordered demonstrators to wear masks, and when they refused, police fired water cannons at them. And finally tonight, Pope Francis reminds the faithful that the Blessed Virgin Mary is an example to us all, in part because she teaches us how to pray.
Prega come madre e prega come discepola.
At his weekly talk at the Vatican, the Holy Father says Our Lady rejected fear and embraced prayer. And we can do the same in our lives by giving all of our worries to the Lord and asking Him to be with us every step of the way. And we thank you for watching tonight. For the entire EWTN News Nightly team, I'm Tracy Sable. Good night and God bless.